I'm Mahmoud Sharara. I'm assistant professor and extension specialist at the Bio and Ag Engineering at NC State University. Nutrient balance is an important concept in agriculture in general, and in animal production in particular. Really, it relates to the balance of nutrients that are generated by the animals in the form of manures and how they are efficiently utilized by the growing crops. In certain situations, when we have a higher concentration of animal production in a region, more so than the crop production, we end up with a certain imbalance between these nutrients coming in from the manure and their crop needs in that particular area. And this is one of the challenges our growers here in North Carolina are facing, which is improving the nutrient use efficiency by sending these nutrients to a wider distribution circle. Our ideal goal is really to create that circular economy that ties the feed to grow the animals and the manure from the animals to grow the feed. One of the common approaches for manure management has been solid liquid separation, which basically allows us to separate the liquid part of the manure that is rich in nitrogen from the solid part that is rich in phosphorus and other minerals. Many of our growers we talk to have indicated a need for a technology to overcome the challenge of the buildup of solids in a lot of our lagoons. These solids can reduce the treatment efficiency and reduce the flexibility they have in terms of managing the lagoon to ensure compliance and to respond to climate conditions.
So my name is Becky Spearman. I'm the County Extension Director and Livestock Agent in Bladen County for North Carolina Cooperative Extension. Extension agents work with growers on their waste plans, making sure that they're staying in compliance and all the rules and regulations that impact those farms. One of the things that we get a lot of questions about is what to do with sludge. You know, we have the traditional pump and haul method, which is lowering the lagoon water out, and then they'll dredge out or pump out that sludge and land apply it and use it as a fertilizer source. And then we've had the geotextile bags that have shown promise.
When we started to look in the industrial scale for technologies that we can import into animal agriculture, we found that drying has been used widely in industrial and wastewater treatment technologies. Obviously, one of the challenges we have here in North Carolina is the rainfall and the humidity. We are in a subtropical region, which has a higher humidity, and that really creates a challenge for drying. The concept of greenhouse drying really relies on two components to create a drying effect. The first concept, or the first component, is the mechanical ventilation. The structure has a mechanical vent, large fans, similar to what we see in animal production barns, and their function is really to move air at a higher velocity or higher speed to essentially to exchange the air over the material and introduce air with a higher drying potential. The second part in this process really has to do with the capture of the solar energy. The structure really accumulates solar radiation coming through the covers and increases the temperature inside the greenhouse. One of the facts that we know about the process of drying is that as we increase the temperature of the air, we increase its water removal capacity. The other aspect is, as we increase the temperature of a material, we increase the water activity, which allows the material to lose the moisture easier than at lower temperature. So really, by combining the air velocity with the mechanical ventilation and the solar energy capture, we're able to affect solar energy drying at a faster rate.
I'm James Cox. I'm the Environmental Projects Manager at Smithfield. We're in Duplin County, close to Warsaw, at a Smithfield company-owned farm that we have built two greenhouses on to dry sludge in. NC State has been a very good partner with us. They have done a lot of work characterizing the issue in total, the material, the logistics, the costs, the methods of removal, post-removal handling. So it's been very important for us to work with them and their knowledge base. The sludge that's originating here came from the lagoon that's located on the farm. This particular lagoon has been in operation 20 plus years. Most have been operating into 30 plus years, and most have not had a sludge removal, but the time is coming when it's going to be needed. We chose a commercially available greenhouse. There's many other selections that could be made, designs. There's some that are cheaper, so there's options. There's not one set way of doing it, but we're in the process of learning. We remove the sludge by dewatering and using geotextile bags. We've taken that material out of the geotubes and we've placed it into the greenhouses. So that's the starting point for the drying process. What we're doing requires tillage, and that's with a tractor. I do a lot of observing, material characteristics, drying, what's happening, different times of the day. We have sensors throughout the house that's monitoring conditions inside and outside, and we're able to look at that through a control system on-site and remotely to make changes as needed. Beyond that, we're looking at what management can we do to enhance the drying. Is that tilling? What can we do material handling wise to help enhance the drying? The completion of the drying process, we're using a simple loader, skid steer loader, to load it out. Depending on where it's going, it could go to further processing to a fertilizer blender or producer. It could be possibly go to as far as a co-fuel for incineration. It could be put in a spreader to go to a field for direct application.
This technology has a great potential to improve swine waste management here in North Carolina. We are creating a material that has been exposed to high temperature for prolonged periods of time, and we remove the moisture from it, which makes it stable for storage and for wider distribution compared to the fresh material coming out of our lagoons or our barns. It also allows us to reach a lot of crop acres that have not been previously accessible to our swine producers to use these nutrients. Because we are relying on solar energy for heat, we are really reducing the cost associated with producing this unit of fertilizer. And that allows us not to create a recycled nutrient source, but also with the low inputs, which is very important, especially when we are focusing on the priorities of reducing the climate impact or the global warming potential associated with all our activities.
My name is Roy Lee Lindsay. I'm the CEO at the North Carolina Pork Council. We've always been focused on how do we get just a little bit better every day. Farmers have been doing sustainability for centuries. Every year we look for how can we use just a little bit less water? How can we use a little bit less fertilizer? How can we get a little more pork production per pound of grain that we had grown, that we were feeding to our animals? These are the kinds of projects, studying new technologies, looking at new options that allow us to continue to make those small steps forward and make everybody more competitive, more sustainable. In our world, sustainability has to include profitable. And if this allows us to take a product that otherwise we were looking for something to do with and turn it maybe into a profit center, reduce costs somewhere else, that's a tremendous bonus for our producers.